När kriget hade pågått i 6 veckor lyfte ett antal stealthplan för ett rutinmässigt bombanfall mot Bagdad. En intensiv flygbombning pågick alltjämt som förberedelse för offensiven som skulle befria Kuwait. Kvällens mål var en byggnad som tillhörde underrättelsetjänsten, och de allierade inte visste var att det fanns brittiska fångar i huset.
There's a flash and the whole place just went up. The ceiling came in, the walls were coming down, the tiles were blown off the walls. Then you hear the second bomb coming in, and by that stage you're fully curled up in a ball, and that's when you hear, and it's deafening as it comes in, and somebody kind of shouted, incoming. After 3 bombs I thought, that's it, I'm now going to die. And it was actually a calming experience. I just sat down and thought, I'm going to die.
Trots förödelsen fortsatte Saddam att utmana de allierade. För att befria Kuwait krävdes det en markoffensiv.
The president said now, Colin, you and Norm are really sure that air power alone can't do it. And my response was, Mr. President, I wish to God that I could assure you that air power alone could do it. But you can't take that chance.
Allas blickar riktades nu mot Norman Schwarzkopf. Tiden före markoffensiven plågades han av oro för att förlusterna skulle bli kolossala. Trycket på honom var starkt. Hans raseriutbrott var allmänt kända.
Working with Norman Schwarzkopf, it was sort of like watching a thermometer. The blood would start around the shirt collar and then it would work its way up to the jawline and then to the ears. And by the time it got to the ears, you ought to watch out.
I would say that working for General Schwarzkopf was a privilege and an honor, but there were many times when if someone had asked me if I would rather have been in that war room or in a dental chair having a root canal without anesthesia, I probably would have chosen the dental chair.
Schwarzkopf var fruktad av sina medarbetare. Britterna iakttog honom med stigande förvåning.
Norman going ballistic put people off their jobs and took their eye off the ball. But on the upside, he was a brilliant military strategist with a lot of experience. He was understood the Arabs and the Arab world, and he was a great diplomat and was able to bring nations along and foreign armies along in a way that a lesser man would not have been able to.
When human lives are on the line, you cannot be cavalier. You can't do enough. You cannot do enough. You must do everything you possibly can and leave no stone unturned, and you can't settle. You can never settle for second best or a second class solution when you're dealing with enterprises of such magnitude that they involve the lives of literally thousands and thousands and thousands of people.
Paul och Cheney flög till Saudiarabien för att orientera sig om planerna. Schwarzkopf sa att han skulle anfalla tidigast om 2 veckor.
Dick liked Norm, respected Norm, had confidence in Norm. But every now and then Dick reflected on the fact that this was a very important operation. It was for all the marbles, as we say. And Norm was known to be volatile. Norm was known to be also reluctant. I sort of get the tag for being the reluctant warrior, but you won't find many of my military colleagues who were anxious to race into this before we were ready to race into it.
Trots bombanfallen hade Saddam Hussein fortfarande 400 000 man i Kuwait bakom minfält, skyttegravar och taggtråd. Han trodde att Irak skulle kunna hejda de allierade och tvinga fram ett blodigt ställningskrig. Och att USA efter Vietnamkriget inte ville utsätta sig för svåra förluster.
كان يعتقد بأن القوات الأمريكية ليست مستعدة للاشتباك البري. وكان يعتقد بأن درس فيتنام كان قاسيا للإدارة الأمريكية.
Schwarzkopf var bekymrad. Han använde B-52 från Vietnamtiden till att bomba de irakiska styrkorna som hade grävt ner sig i Kuwait. 72 000 bomber fälldes. De flesta föll över öde öken. Man upptäckte ett programmeringsfel i B-52-ornas navigeringssystem. Men också när det hade rättats till fördes bomberna ofta ur kurs av starka vindar.
We thought that we would destroy tanks somewhere between the 20 and 30 a day, and we weren't coming anywhere close. We were down in the area of 6 or 8. And so after about 10 days of that, I knew that we had to do something different.
Nu skickade Glosson ut två stridsplan av typ F1-11 på ett uppdrag som skulle få långtgående följder. När planen kom fram till de irakiska linjerna fann piloterna att till och med de bäst kamouflerade stridsvagnarna avtecknade sig som en vit rektangel på deras värmesökande kameror. Stridsvagnarna hade hettats upp av solljuset. Och till skillnad från B-52-orna hade F1-11-orna laserstyrda bomber.
3, 2, 1, impact. Okay, sequence me.
I called General Gloss and I said, Buster, you wouldn't believe how successful we were tonight. It was really shit hot. We had 7 for 8 direct hits. Piece of cake.
Hundratals stridsvagnar slogs ut en efter en. Under trycket av de ständiga bombningarna började den irakiska armén upplösas. Vad de allierade inte kände till var att omkring 200 000 irakiska soldater deserterade.
Shawhabu dakarat det här. Roshabu dakarat det här. Am dakarat det här. Murrami akardu. Shawharami akardu. Rosharami akardu. Shawros harunagu. Tarinabu. Har ma'adal agru. Asen abari lomatika. Har tiara det här rami akardu. Awasu awahat. Awa asmana hamu tiara. Awa det här tu rami akardu. Asu. Sa'at yagnabu. Du sa'al nabu. Yagdaqa mazal nabu. مستمر لسلسبو لي أداي كاتبونه
أما آثارها فقد كانت مدمرة. فقد أقول لك فشيء، مثلا كنا نأتي إلى فرقة مشاة يبلغ تعدادها 15,000 شخص، أصبح موجودها 34 شخصا فقط. فكم إذن نستطيع أن نقول أصبحت صفر؟ 34 من 15,000.
Colin Powell och Dick Cheney återvände från besöket hos Schwarzkopf. De talade om för en otålig George Bush att de allierade kunde anfalla om 2 veckor. Bush ville inte ha några uppskov. Moskvas stöd som var så viktigt för alliansen höll på att försvagas. Tidigare samma dag hade Sovjet föreslagit att anfallet skulle uppskjutas för att ge tid för förhandlingar.
We are not going to suit somebody else's timetable, whether he lives in Baghdad or any place else.
När krigskabinettet möttes för att gå igenom anfallsplanen framförde Powell en allvarlig varning. Markstriderna skulle bli blodigare än presidenten kunde föreställa sig.
I was quite confident we would be successful because we had put together a decisive force. But no plan survives first contact with a real enemy.
Colin made a very eloquent statement warning everybody it was going to be a lot uglier and a lot messier than they thought. The battle would not go as the plans said, and that he had an obligation to warn the president about casualties, that there were unpredictable circumstances in war, and that once it started, the president was no longer in control.
Men presidentens otålighet var berättigad.
By missile or by bomb?
By rockets.
This is by...
Gorbachev hade skickat en högt uppsatt diplomat till Bagdad. Yevgeni Primakovs uppgift var att försöka få Saddam att gå med på en uppgörelse som skulle rädda hans ansikte. Primakov fick först beskåda förödelsen och förde sen till en av regeringens gästvillor i centrala Bagdad.
Он зашел в длинной шинели, было холодно, буржуйка такая. Эта печка такая горела, там была зажжена электрическая. Но потом, когда мы остались одни, тогда вот начался настоящий разговор. И он тогда первый раз сказал прямо: «Хорошо, я выведу свои войска из Кувейта. Единственное, что я хочу, чтобы мне бы не стреляли в спину».
48 timmar innan markanfallet skulle börja kom Iraks utrikesminister Tariq Aziz till Moskva. När Saddam hade sagt att han var villig att lämna Kuwait satte Sovjetunionen igång frenetiska diplomatiska ansträngningar för att rädda sin gamla bundsförvant från nederlag.
Gorbachev, to me, was making one last attempt to try and have it both ways. He wanted to stay with the United States in the course of this conflict, and yet he also wanted, was under, I think, great pressure from various elements of the Soviet bureaucracy to try and preserve this client relationship with the Iraqis and with Saddam Hussein, who after all had been a Soviet client for many, many years.
Aziz begav sig direkt till Kreml. Den sovjetiske presidenten väntade. Aziz sa till Gorbachev att han inte kunde godta de FN-resolutioner som krävde att Irak skulle erkänna Kuwaits självständighet och betala skadestånd. Men Irak gick med på att lämna Kuwait. Gorbachev tyckte att det var tillräckligt och ringde upp Washington.
Gorbachev called the president saying, look, I've worked this out whereby we can get Saddam out of Kuwait without a war.
Я президенту Бушу сказал: "Джордж, ведь вообще говоря, вы должны и мы все должны думать не только о том, как начать, но потом как кончить эти военные действия, как выходить из этого конфликта. Вот мы с вами генералы там должны думать, как операцию провести успешнее, чтобы она была эффективнее, а мы должны думать, как выйти из этого".
We kept coming back to him and saying, "No, you continually are suggesting approaches which do not require an unconditional withdrawal. And we were never, 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 never going to accept a negotiating down from the UN resolutions."
Trots allt samlade presidenten sina rådgivare till ett avgörande möte. De hade blivit erbjudna det som de hela tiden hade önskat sig, en irakisk reträtt utan något blodigt markkrig. Men då skulle Saddam undkomma ostraffad och utan att ha blivit besegrad. Bush ringde upp Gorbachev och meddelade att förslaget var oacceptabelt.
It was a very difficult phone call for the president and a very anguished one for Gorbachev.
Тем не менее, мы должны сейчас не терять время и искать политически. Он говорит: "Я заинтересован в этом. Пойми меня, я заинтересован, чтобы сейчас политически решить вопрос. Но ничего же пока не получается". Ну, я призывал не терять настроение, не терять волю, не торопиться, а продолжая действовать вместе, тем не менее, выходить на политическое решение.
The president just said, no, I'm sorry. You know, he's had all the chances. He's had months. He's had from August 2nd, we have given him every opportunity. And we've told him that this aggression would not stand. And now it's too late.
Bush could have said, okay, let us have a ceasefire and then discuss the other matters. He did not accept the ceasefire. He continued the war according to his own schedule. He didn't care about what Gorbachev said and reached with me. He had a schedule.
Alliansen knakade i fogarna. Frankrikes president François Mitterrand ringde upp och begärde mer tid för diplomatiska ansträngningar. Men då ingrep Saddam Hussein.
We received word that Saddam had blown the oil wells, and I went rushing up to the Oval Office, and Bush used it right then in the telephone call with Mitterrand, sort of, "François, we've just received this piece of information that shows that we cannot delay, that Saddam is going to produce a catastrophe in Kuwait. He's already set all the oil wells on fire, and God knows what he may do next." And that pretty well resolved that issue.
Två arméer stod stridsberedda mot varandra.
The coalition will give Saddam Hussein until noon Saturday to do what he must do. Begin his immediate and unconditional withdrawal from Kuwait.
Hundratals oljekällor stod i brand över hela Kuwait. Saddam Hussein ville förstöra allt han inte kunde behålla. Han tog ingen notis om USAs ultimatum. Om han hade fogat sig hade han blivit förödmjukad i arabvärldens ögon.
I have therefore directed General Norman Schwarzkopf to use all forces available to eject the Iraqi army from Kuwait.
More than anything else in those final hours, I was asking myself, what did I forget? What have I missed? What more can I do? Once you have thrown the dice in the air, you can't call them back. At that point, all you can do is wait until they land on the table to see what the numbers come up. And that is a very awkward time because you can just sit there on your hands and wait. There's nothing more you can do.
Planen gick ut på att först låta marinkåren anfalla rakt in i Kuwait. Schwarzkopf hoppades att det skulle få elitförbanden i det republikanska gardet att gå söderut för att slå tillbaka anfallet. 65 mil västerut skulle franska och amerikanska styrkor samtidigt slå en ring runt slagfältet. Arabiska styrkor skulle understödja anfallet mot Kuwait. 24 timmar efter den första stöten skulle amerikanernas och britternas tunga pansar bryta igenom den irakiska fronten och anfalla genom den västra öknen där försvarslinjerna var uttunnade.
I always thought that there was a reason why they left the west open and that this was would be a place where they would lay down a biological attack, whether it be anthrax or whether it be botulism.
The Iraqis had chemical weapons. We knew that. They had biological weapons. We knew that. They had used them. We knew that. And they were going to be fighting what Saddam Hussein called the mother of all battles.
And I had my intelligence staff using terms like chemical killing sack, nuclear detonation area, and this sort of thing to describe possible scenarios as to why that area was left open.
I would wake up in the middle of the night in cold sweat just thinking about, would they use them? Would they use them in the area out west where there was not a lot of troops and we thought there must be a reason for that.
Schwarzkopfs plan innebar att marinkårens befälhavare Walt Boomer skulle bli den första som ledde sina trupper i strid. Trots övertaget i luften befarade Boomer att en stormning av minfälten och taggtrådshindren i södra Kuwait skulle kosta honom stora förluster genom massiva insatser av kemiska vapen och nervgas från irakiernas sida. Britterna hade övat anfall tillsammans med marinkåren men dragits ur för 2 månader sedan.
It was the frontal attack and it was going to be across straight into the Iraqi main defensive positions. And to have gone ahead committing a British division that wasn't even suited to that type of warfare to that and take unnecessarily heavy casualties, if I'd agreed to that, I wouldn't have been doing my job and I think I should have been removed from command.
We were outnumbered when we attack into Kuwait. Sometimes people have lost sight of that. But in addition to being outnumbered, there was this overriding concern, overwhelming concern about chemical warfare. This just occupied most of my waking moments.
Under röken från de brinnande oljekällorna drog stormtrupperna på sig de otympliga skyddsdräkter som kanske skulle rädda deras liv vid ett anfall med kemiska vapen. Oron för att marinkåren skulle drabbas av stora förluster hade dessförinnan utlöst en märklig konfrontation.
Weather conditions were absolutely critical. And the weather predictions that we were getting at that time were very mixed. The Marines, as you probably know, do not have a lot of heavy artillery and depend upon their aircraft to provide the close air support to replace the artillery. And Walt Boomer came to me and said he was very concerned about launching his attack when the weather was predicted to be so bad.
I Pentagon fick Colin Powell ett samtal från Schwarzkopf som begärde att markkriget skulle skjutas upp.
But we have a president who is anxious to get this over with. And I went and talked to Norm on the phone and said, Norm, look, this is getting hard to explain. And I took him through why it was getting hard to explain, and he just had it. He exploded and said, you know, you do not understand my problem. You're talking in political terms. If you don't care about the lives of young people, well, I do. That did it. I exploded, and I started shouting back at him. You know, I care as much as you do, but there's a limit. And I have to work in both the political world and the military world.
When you're caught in the middle on something like that, it's not a pleasant position to be in, and it puts you under more strain than you were already under, just in the strain of undertaking the type of thing that we were getting ready to do.
He said, Colin, I think I'm losing it. I feel my head's in a vice. I said, you're not losing it. If you have a total confidence, we got a problem. We'll work our way through this problem. And then about 30 minutes later, Norm called and said, the weather's fine. We can go.
Marinkårens ingenjörssoldater började krypande ta sig fram genom en flera kilometer lång zon med minfält, bunkrar och taggtrådshinder som skyddade Iraks frontlinje. Med käppar av fiberglas letade de efter minor för att sedan märka ut en säker rutt åt de första framrusande förbanden.
You see mines everywhere. You can look left and right and you see mines, half-buried mines, full view mines. Just as far as you can see, you look left and right, and there's desert, and there's just lines and lines and lines and groups of mines out there. We crawled, low crawled, which is on your belly, probing along with the fiberglass rods. 70 meters in front of you, Iraqis. Marine snipers are behind us trying to suppress Iraqis that are moving through the trench lines. You hear artillery, mortars, small arms.
Under ständig beskjutning stakade Restifo ut stigar genom två minfält som låg i anfallets huvudriktning. Samtidigt var 17 000 marinsoldater på väg mot Kuwaits stränder. Två veckor tidigare hade man haft långt framskridna planer på en landstigning, men försvaret var så starkt att utgången hade blivit katastrofal. Nu ville Schwarzkopf få irakierna att tro att en landstigning var omedelbart förestående. För att förstärka skenmanövern fick löjtnant Tom Dietz order om att placera ut bomber på en strand i närheten av huvudstaden för att ge försvararna intryck av att man förberedde ett landstigningsområde.
We swam to a point where we were in about 5 feet of water, the entire time keeping our weapon focused on the beach. We moved in to where we were actually crawling in about 2 feet of water, and then to a point where the bomb was in 1 foot of water. We placed it on the bottom, again our weapons trained on the beach, and we just reversed the process. And we swam back and rendezvoused with our two boats. We were standing there watching, and all of a sudden the first explosion goes.
Slagskeppet Missouri sköt artillerield mot stranden med sina 40 cm kanoner för att göra illusionen fullständig. Missouri var med i andra världskriget. Många av granaterna hade tillverkats på 30-talet. Några månader senare skulle de sista slagskeppen tas ur bruk och granaterna skickas till ett museum. Men bombardemanget fick avsedd verkan. Irakiska styrkor flyttades till kusten, bort från det avsnitt där marinkåren skulle anfalla.
First Marine Division will cross west of the Owapra in zone at approximately 0-1200 at H hour. Across the line.
Ute i öknen höll marinkårens förbandschefer en sista genomgång. De väntade sig hårda strider.
While I remain apprehensive about some of their capability, I'm also confident that we can work through that. I think we can work through their chemical capability.
Anfallet tog sin början.
I don't think anyone predicted that the Marines would get much farther than maybe 5 kilometers. At the very most, maybe 8. And that then, with the enormous, overwhelming forces that were arrayed in that area, that it would stop the Marines.
We're going through the breach.
Men när dagen grydde fick generalerna klart för sig att någonting märkligt hade hänt. Marinkårens fordonskolonner körde rakt igenom de fientliga ställningarna medan marinkårssången ljöd ur högtalarna.
Iraqi fighting positions.
Medan det allierade flyget höll utkik efter motanfall välde tusentals marinsoldater in i Kuwait utan att möta något större motstånd.
Expected casualties somewhere in the 25-30% range, but there was essentially no firefights, essentially no battles. The Iraqis were there, but they chose, they elected not to fight. In many respects, they could retreat and they could surrender much faster than we could attack or advance, and that the war really became a war of collection of enemy prisoners of war.
Efter 6 veckors intensiva bombningar från de allierade sida hade de irakiska värnpliktssoldaterna i främsta linjen förklarat för sig att allt motstånd var lönlöst. När anfallet kom hade hälften redan deserterat. De som stannat kvar hade drabbats av krigsneuroser och väntade gråtande på att få ge upp. Saddam Hussein nåddes av nyheten i Bagdad.
فكان يقول بصراحة يعني يقول مع الأسف تخنث الشباب تخنث الرجال أي لم يقاتل الرجال هذا شيء لا يليق بجيشنا ولكن الجيش لم يكن مؤمنا بهذه الحرب وكانت حربا قذرة.
Marinkårens stridsvagnar vände nu mot Saddams andra försvarslinje som bestod av pansarförband ur den reguljära armén. I stridsledningen väntade man på den första insatsen av kemiska vapen. Men i Bagdad hade man beslutat annorlunda.
We didn't think that it was wise to use them. That's all what I can say, that it was not wise to use such kind of weapons in such kind of a war with such an enemy.
Om ett stort antal marinsoldater hade dödats med kemiska vapen på sin väg genom minfälten hade Pentagon svarat med att sätta Bagdad under 2 meter djupt vatten.
Knocking off the dams on the Tigris and Euphrates rivers would have caused enormous destruction downstream. The loss of civilian life would have been terrible, and we really had not thoroughly analyzed. We knew how to hit the dams, but I don't know if we analyzed what the effect downstream would have been. But nevertheless, it would have been a good one to threaten the Iraqis with. And of course, there was always the implicit threat of nuclear weapons. I don't think we ever would have used them, but nevertheless, the Iraqis didn't know that. And we could have if provocation was serious enough.
Under de första timmarna tillfångatogs 8000 irakier. Efter Vietnamkriget hade den amerikanska militären svurit på att aldrig mer underskatta en fiende. Men i Vietnam var fienden beredd att dö för sin sak.
My own guess is that about 75% of them gave up and about 25% fought. As the day wore on, I began to become elated.
I general Schwarzkopfs lägesrum blandades lättnaden med rädsla för massiva motanfall, men det kom inga. Under dagen började det stå klart för Schwarzkopf att marinkårens framgångar äventyrade hans planer på att locka Saddams republikanska garde i en fälla. Marinkåren hade ryckt fram så snabbt att det republikanska gardet inte hunnit vända söderut för att gå till motanfall. Schwarzkopfs plan på att lura in dem i en förödande fälla höll på att gå om intet. Och de amerikanska och brittiska pansarförbanden skulle inte gå till anfall förrän nästa dag. Det skulle ge republikanska gardet tid att undkomma.
I decided to move the main attack up to 3 o'clock in the afternoon. One of the principles of the overall campaign was to inflict as much damage on the Republican Guard as we possibly could, and they were sitting very, very deep, you know, out back in the desert. And so, therefore, it became obvious that if we were going to inflict that damage on the Republican Guard, we had to go ahead and inflict it as early as possible.
Under de 30 minuterna närmast före anfallet sköt det brittiska och amerikanska artilleriet 11 000 granater mot den irakiska fronten. Det var första gången britterna använde MLRS, en avfyrningsramp som sköt flera missiler samtidigt. Varje missil exploderade ovanför de fientliga trupperna och spred ut hundratals granater. På 30 minuter slog över 600 000 granater ner över de irakiska ställningarna. Generalen som ledde attacken var en noggrann och metodisk militär. Han hade varit med förut. I Vietnam miste han ena benet.
Memories of Vietnam are very sharp, clear to me. I mean, never far from my mind, and especially during the Gulf War. We didn't say it to each other, but I think we all felt that we're going to do it right this time.
När stormelden avtog välde amerikanska och brittiska styrkor fram genom öknen. Det här var de styrkor som varit stationerade i Europa för att utkämpa det tredje världskriget mot Sovjetunionen. Nu, när det kalla kriget var över, kunde de sättas in mot Irak. Generalerna räknade med att det skulle ta 2 dagar att bryta igenom de främre försvarslinjerna, vilket skulle följas av 6 dagars hårda pansarstrider mot det republikanska gardet.
I thought that we would lose somewhere between, in the breaching units, that we would lose somewhere between 20% and 40%.
Amerikanernas första infanteridivision hade till uppgift att storma skyttegravarna för att röja väg för de brittiska stridsvagnarna. För att undvika närstrider tänkte man begrava de irakiska försvararna levande.
A thought occurred to me, we could actually use these plows to fill in the trenches. In fact, I tested it myself. I got down in the ditch myself and had 2 tanks plow towards me just to see what it did. I learned several things. One is I learned that it happens very quickly. So the defender has a choice to make, but he has to make it very quickly. He can either give up and hop out of the trench. He can try to run down the trench and get away. But he better do those quickly because these things move at amazing speed down there.
Det gick en sandbarriär längs den irakiska gränsen. Bortom vallen låg ett 8 kilometer brett minfält och sen irakiska skyttegravar.
You got the first one. First berm in a minute. That's real good. The second one's a tougher one.
Bandschaktare och stridsvagnar med plogar började bryta igenom vallen. Tätfordonet kördes av en 18-årig soldat som hette Joe Queen.
The Iraqis are on the side of the berm. And nobody knows where they're at until we cut through the berm.
First tank into Iraq!
Beskyddad av stridsvagnarna plöjde Queen igenom minfältet fram till skyttegravarna.
What we did is we just took the dirt that the Iraqi soldiers had dug out and put behind the trench. You just pushed that dirt right back into the trench. You could just look at the man's eyes and see fear. You know, you see him scared. You know, you're looking at a man's, the whites of his eyes as you're going through in the trench with this bulldozer covering in the trench. And they were firing at the bulldozer. And when the first bullet that hit the blade, that made me know then, hey, look, this is for real. There's no game. Those are real bullets, and a bullet will kill you.
10 mil skyttegravar plöjdes igen. De flesta irakier gav upp. Arméns officiella beräkning är att 150 man begravdes. Joe Queen själv plöjde 3 mil i sträck.
You don't think about, hey, what about this guy? What about that guy? He had a chance to get out. He had every opportunity to get out. And he took the way to die for his country, just like any American would.
Före gryningen hade 10 grupper ur specialförbanden flugits in i förväg och gömt sig bakom fiendens linjer. Från sina gömställen spanade de efter tecken på ett irakiskt motanfall eller insatser av kemiska vapen och kärnvapen. En av grupperna, Alpha 525, gömde sig inne i vallen till en dräneringskanal.
There was two girls and a small boy, and they come up and actually looked into the peephole, into the face of the sergeant that was inside the peephole. Two of my soldiers left the hide site, the back of it, into the ditch with automatic silence weapons and a silenced pistol, and actually had these children in the sights of the pistol and inquiring of me, what are we going to do? What should we do with these children? Should we shoot them? And I know in my heart had I told them to shoot, they would have shot them children. But it was an instantaneous decision. No, we're not going to shoot children. It's not their war.
Alpha 525 anföll snart av 150 soldater. De dödade 40, men anfallen fortsatte.
I can remember feeling inside myself that, my gosh, we're all going to die here. There's no way that we can get out of this. They would mount attacks and they would give out a yell, an Arab battle cry, like, and it was terrifying.
Man kallade dit amerikanska F-16-plan. Männen på marken signalerade sin position med hjälp av en spegel. Flygplanets kameror filmade vad som hände sen. Den första rösten tillhör Alfa-gruppens radiosignalist.
Please drop cluster bombs for personnel, approximately a platoon-size element, 500 meters due north of my location. Be over.
500. Okay, understand that due north of your location, and I'm going to drop a bomb about 1,000 meters north of your position.
Roger that.
Make sure he understands this is cluster bombs. This is danger close.
If you understand our ordinance is cluster bombs.
Roger that. Ordinance is cluster bombs. Affirmative, over.
That's affirmed. We got bombs away now.
When we'd see the bombs come in, I'm sure that everyone to the man was thinking, I hope those things don't come in on us, because they actually crossed right over top of us. And then you can hear the bombs actually hitting and start out as a small vibration and work into a crescendo and then come back down. And at the end of the crescendo, as it breaks down, you can hear the Iraqi soldiers, you know, yelling out and screaming because these bombs had hit the target.
Negative. Target, open target. Good job.
And guard, keep your head down. We got some more coming in.
Roger that.
We stopped for a moment to, you know, to get our senses and listen, and you could hear breathing. We was that close to, you know, to the Iraqis, you could hear. We popped around the corner, and there, as close as 10 feet from us, they were hunkered down in the canal, and actually their weapons were laying down in the canal. So they were down trying to protect themselves from the airstrike that we had just called. And as they seen this, they grabbed their weapons. Of course, our weapons were at the ready. You know, the heart jumped into my throat as we pulled the trigger and, you know, unloaded into the point element. And dropped that point element, eliminated it. And as we walked by and looked at the bodies there, it was sort of a profound thought. You know, we had to take the lives of these people. And it really wasn't until we was on the helicopter and well on our way back that finally it hit me, like, we made it out of here without a single soldier hurt, which was a miracle.
Det var söndag morgon i Washington. President Bush väntade på nyheter. Om förlusterna blev svåra äventyrade det hans ställning som president och kunde leda till att kriget stoppades.
I got briefed just before I went into the church. The president was right ahead of me. I passed him a note that said, Mr. President, things are going very well. We all went back to the White House. I got out a map from Time magazine to sort of show him exactly what was happening. And I was able to tell him there that things were going extraordinarily well. We had assumed that the toughest part of the ground war in terms of casualties would have been the early hours of that conflict. And in fact, what we were finding was that the air war had been enormously effective and decimated the Iraqi forces and that they, in fact, were collapsing in front of us.
Under andra dagen ryckte marinsoldaterna fram mot Kuwait City. Framför dem låg, trodde de, Saddams andra försvarslinje, de välutrustade pansardivisionerna ur den reguljära irakiska armén. Men nu kom irakierna med en överraskning. Från de brinnande oljefälten på marinsoldaternas högra flank ryckte hundratals irakiska stridsvagnar fram. Amerikanerna omgrupperade. Det här var ett motanfall som Saddam Hussein personligen hade godkänt.
Ana a'taraftu ala dhalik. Qult ana la u'ayyid hadha al-hujum li'anna al-alwiya allati taraja'at nahtaj li'isti'adat amakinha ila quwwa mudha'afa wa mithl hadhihi al-quwwa laysat mawjuda ladayna. Kana ra'yuhu la linatruk al-khiyar liqa'id al-faylaq li'isti'id al-mawadi'. بعد حوالي ساعتين أخبرونا الفيلق بأنهم استعادوا المواضع ونظر صدام إلي وقال ألم نقل أفضل لذلك؟
Marinkårens flygledning förberedde ett motdrag. Order utgick till en grupp på 4 attackhelikoptrar av typ Cobra som var stationerade på en provisorisk flygbas nära den kuwaitiska gränsen. När helikoptrarna lyfte var marinsoldaterna på marken redan inbegripna i det största pansarslaget i kårens historia.
We got the word that there was an Iraqi counterattack. As we arrived out there, we saw horizon to horizon Iraqi tanks, armored vehicles. And as we started hitting these tanks and things started happening in our favor, the attack basically just ground to a halt. All the tanks stopped, the armored vehicles stopped, the hatches flew open. The Iraqis started bailing out of the tanks and, you know, scrambling around in the desert trying to figure out what was going on.
De irakiska trupperna försökte retirera in i röken från oljekällorna.
It was like, you know, something out of a, you know, spaghetti western with the tripwire and the horses falling. It was, you know, as you engage these troops with 20 millimeter, it was the first time I'd ever done that. And they just kind of pitch over in the desert.
Över 100 pansarfordon slogs ut.
Flying over the oil wells, it was like something out of Dante's Inferno. The thick black oil field smoke. A littered battlefield burning tanks. Aircraft flying around. Very surrealistic, and you almost had to slap yourself in reality to go out there and do your mission.
Saddam underrättades om att framryckningen mot Kuwait City hade återupptagits.
كان منزعجا من الجيش انزعاجا شديدا ولذلك لسبب واهي غير موجود اعدم 5 ضباط من كبار ضباط الجيش بتهمة التغاذل والتراجع وأعدمهم في هو حاكمهم هو تولى محاكمتهم وحرس الخاص أعدمهم في الأبواب.
Once we broke that counterattack, we broke their back. That was the last gasp on their part to throw us back out of Kuwait. And from then on, we had a pretty straight shot into the city.
Den kvällen slog en skuddmissil ner i en amerikansk förläggning. 20 soldater dödades, USA:s största förlust dittills. Saddam Hussein hade hela tiden hoppats på att förluster skulle undergräva amerikanernas stridsvilja, men nu var det för sent. Saddam utfärdade en generalorder om reträtt.
Saddam huwa asdar amr al-insihab bi huduri. Wa amr al-insihab huwa lamma bada'at al-harb al-barriya kana ya'isan min annahu yatamakkan min al-ihtifaz bil Kuwait asbaha al-amru mustahilan.
I Kuwait City började irakiska soldater tränga ihop sig i alla fordon de kunde få tag i. En ändlös karavan bildades. De här bilderna togs av motståndsrörelsen i Kuwait.
I frequently talked to the resistance in Kuwait City via satellite telephone. I picked up and it was a colonel from the Kuwaiti Air Force who'd been trapped in Kuwait City. And he'd been in the resistance all this time. He started to tell me about the Iraqis forming up and fleeing the town. He became so emotionally happy, relieved, overjoyed about his country being freed, the terrible oppressors leaving. He started to cry. I'm embarrassed to say it, but I started to cry as well. I've never been so touched in my entire life.
Besättningen på ett F-15-plan som var fullastat med bomber för anfall inne i Irak fick nya order. De skulle anfalla konvojen som var på väg ut ur Kuwait City och stoppa den till varje pris. När besättningen gick ut till planet berättade deras chef hur många som hade dödats av skuddmissilen i Dahran.
I told him the importance of the mission. It's not just a retreating army. And these guys are rapists, killers, murderers. And coincidentally a Scud had just hit Dahran airport and killed 60 Americans. And convinced them, and I'm sure that I did, that they needed to put some hate in their heart and go out and stop those son of a bitches from getting out of Kuwait.
As we dove out of the clouds, the picture was out absolutely astounding. There were thousands of headlights heading on every road that led north out of Kuwait City.
It's almost like hitting the jackpot. I mean, there are vehicles all over the place. It is a very lucrative target.
We had 12 500-pound bombs, and we elected to drop them three at a time.
The bombs impact in a string right across the highway, with the center bomb impacting on in between two trucks, as a matter of fact, causing both of the trucks to burst into flame.
It might have been disorganized, but this was an armed retreat. They were shooting from the vehicles. They were shooting from manned sights on either side of the road. Missiles were fired, some randomly, some aimed.
Bomberna som Kraus och Seidel fällde slog ut fordonen i täten och vållade ett enormt trafikkaos. Snart anlände fler flygplan. De hade hunnit få med sig multipelbomber.
لو بينا نفر زور كوتبو همو برينار وهبو برينار وهبو زور برينار وهبو نسوشتي باريبو أمانا طبعا لو كانت هيجو سائلين أبو كخلق بجوزية تواني بس إما لو حالة حازبون يكسرها شوني بها هاتن هبو بنيو مردوي بنيو مردوي هاتن يعني يوز بين بو أو ناو سارك إما بلان فريانا كوتن طبعا إما جغم أنبو أقر جغم أنبو يا هل بسر ما نخصن بلان جغم أنبو بحمو قوتي أخواني ششابة سارك إما کاتکس خوانش همون جامو شتی سرکی مامو هنابو چی پیالن همون خوانایی بو امش چکا جگه من نبو یک سلی من روشتین
پیلوتنا کالده ده دادنز موتورویگ تری داگر افتر مرکریگتز برگان var den armé som hade ockuperat Kuwait City inte längre stridsduglig. Tusentals fotavtryck försvann ut i öknen. Hundratals hade blivit dödade. Det som hände här skulle under de närmaste timmarna få stor betydelse för att kriget avslutades.
Why did we bomb them? Because there was a great deal of military equipment on that highway. I had given orders to all of my commanders that I wanted every piece of Iraqi equipment that we possibly could destroyed. This was not a bunch of innocent people just trying to make their way back across the border to Iraq. This was a bunch of
of rapists, murderers, and thugs who had raped and pillaged downtown Kuwait City and now were trying to get out of the country before they were caught.
Senare under dagen fick också britterna känna på flygets förstörelseförmåga. Den brittiska divisionen hade avvikit från amerikanernas anfallsriktning för att angripa de irakiska reserverna bakom den gamla frontlinjen. Det handlade mest om att samla upp tusentals demoraliserade soldater. Irakierna dödade en enda brittisk soldat. Men strax före klockan tre intog britterna en irakisk ställning. Två brittiska pansarfordon fullastade med infanterister gick i ställning in till de irakiska skyttegravarna. Vad som hände sen är fortfarande omtvistat. Britterna hävdar att de meddelade amerikanerna var de befann sig, men det förnekas av amerikanerna. Säkert är dock att medan britterna gjorde sig klara för att förstöra de irakiska pjäsvärnen drog två amerikanska A-10-or slutsatsen att det rörde sig om fientliga fordon.
It was just like a flash. And then suddenly you got this searing pain across your face and your hands up.
And then all of a sudden, I had this vision of myself floating up towards the air. And I remember saying to myself, "Well, you know, that's your numbers up, sort of thing. Now this, you're on your way to heaven."
And I looked down and I saw this blood coming through my clothing. From the top of my thigh, and realised then at that stage I'd been hurt.
Trevor was crawling on his hands and knees and his belly towards the rear of the vehicle. It was all black. There was, you know, he'd suffered burns. He'd suffered leg injuries.
I look in the back of the vehicle. And what I saw in the back of my vehicle, I would never want to see anything like that again in my life.
And I realised that two lads who died in the rear of the vehicle who were sitting next to me.
And I see the second vehicle, the vehicle that had come round to help us, is suddenly going in and out like a pressurised can. It's expanding and contracting and expanding and then contracting. And I realised in that split second that vehicle was going to explode.
9 soldater dog. Under kriget dödades minst 35 amerikaner, en fjärdedel av USA:s totala förluster av eld från egna styrkor.
In war, you know, people get killed, it's inevitable. You know, we're fighting against them, they're fighting against us. If it'd been an Iraqi plane, well, fair dues, you know, that you'd expect to be shot at by the enemy, but you don't expect to be shot at by your own side.
Ett amerikanskt spionplan tog den här bilden av slagfältet. Den visade hur Saddams bästa trupper, det republikanska gardet, började fly. General Schwarzkopf var ursinnig över att amerikanerna ännu inte hade fått stridskontakt med gardets drygt 60 000 man och deras pansar.
Here we have the golden opportunity to accomplish far beyond our dreams. What it is we set out to accomplish and to get this thing over once and for all very quickly, and it doesn't seem like we are able to capitalize on that opportunity.
De amerikanska pansarstyrkorna ryckte skyndsamt framåt. Schwarzkopf ville att de skulle gå ännu snabbare. Han hade utgått från att det republikanska gardet skulle gå söderut för att försvara Kuwait, men det skedde aldrig, och nu fick amerikanerna kämpa för att hinna ikapp dem. Schwarzkopf ville ha ett snabbt anfall, men befälhavaren på fältet var mer försiktig.
You get a probability of increased casualties. You get the probability of an attack that starts and stops and starts and stops, loses momentum. I wanted to hit the Republican guards with a three-division fist. I didn't want to poke at them with the fingers, in other words, piecemeal commitment of my forces. I want to hit them with a fist at full speed. At full speed.
General Schwarzkopf indicated, "Ready? Let's get this mission accomplished and let's do it ASAP."
På krigets tredje dag fick man under eftermiddagen äntligen stridskontakt med det republikanska gardet. En spaningsstyrka på 9 stridsvagnar och 12 pansarfordon ledde den amerikanska framryckningen. Framför dem låg det republikanska gardets stridsvagnar i bakhåll bakom en lätt upphöjning i ökenlandskapet. Den första stridsvagnen närmade sig.
As we crested the rise, my gunner identified tanks to our direct front. He said, "Identified tanks." I yelled, "Fire." As I was yelling fire on the intercom, the gun erupted. The round impacted on the frontal slope of the tank and the tank commander was ejected out of the hatch and he himself was in flames. As the other tanks crested the rise, they began to select their targets and engaged in an almost simultaneous manner. So 15 seconds before, there was a cohesive or coherent Iraqi defense. 15 seconds later, that defense was completely in flames. When we look back over the armored vehicles, we think, my God, this is what an armored cavalry troop in the assault can accomplish in that short amount of time.
De kallade striden Ost 73 efter koordinaterna på kartan. 28 irakiska stridsvagnar förstördes. Den natten slog amerikanerna ut en hel division ur det republikanska gardet. De övriga 5 divisionerna inledde en hastig reträtt. Deras chanser att undkomma ökade med hjälp från ett oväntat håll.
Colin Powell and Dick Cheney came over to the White House to give the president their daily report on how the war was going. And by that time we knew both from the military reports and from satellites about the highway of death leading north out of Kuwait City and the incredible destruction of the Iraqi convoys and so on. We knew all this would eventually be on television. And I remember very clearly Colin Powell saying that this thing was turning into a massacre and that to continue it beyond a certain point would be un-American. And he even used the word unchivalrous.
Medan amerikanerna anföll det republikanska gardet låg de irakiska ställningarna kring Kuwait öde. Amerikanska marinsoldater samlades utanför staden. Frågan var nu om man kunde krossa det republikanska gardet innan det blev politiskt lämpligt att stoppa ett krig där man redan hade uppnått det främsta målet, att befria Kuwait.